high over the lower bridge, a certain height above it. The, here is, you may not be able to see, but there's a faint line that showed a ramp that came off that upper bridge that got you, let you down in a straight and relatively gradual path down to Second Avenue North. That's gone. That won't be there. I'll show you in a moment what that has been replaced with. Here you see the crystalline blue water that now I call it the impossible reef. This came out of the contest winning book. That is a view of the underside of the pier as seen from the east, and it's really kind of out of proportion because what you're looking at is really way back yonder, but it was to give you a picture. This, when I saw this, is when I knew that the engineers and or the engineering and scientific work on this was bogus. The 2.5 acres of oyster habitat within the lens is sufficient to clean 20 million gallons of seawater a day. While we can't clarify the entire bay, we can definitely create a clean and highly diverse native aquatic ecosystem inside the confines of the lens. I was chief engineer of a submarine, and I kind of have had numbers in my head forever, like there's 7.5 gallons of water per cubic foot. 2.5 acres is about 100,000 square feet, 10 feet of water, you have a million million cubic feet. That's close to 8 million gallons of seawater in this aquatic preserve with just 2/10 of a knot of current. That entire 8 million gallons of seawater will move away in 15 to 20 minutes. You can play with the numbers anytime. One knot is 1.67 feet per second. That 2.5 acres is roughly 300 feet across. So instead of having to clean 20 million gallons a day, you're having to clean about 72 million gallons a day, to clarify. The scientific community, the wonderful scientific community you have here at Eckerd, College of Marine Science, the government, US CGS, Geodetic Survey, all of them that we have, they were never consulted. This architect came to town on September 19th of 2011 and had to produce this contest concept by November 30th, roughly 75 days. I mean, I can understand them not getting it perfect. And I can also understand them providing a concept. Now, this is the concept as it was presented in December of 2012, a year later, substantially modified. The original concept had no restaurants whatsoever anywhere. It did provide in this area here on the upland for three or four little kiosks for snacks and souvenirs. That was going to be it. Roughly 6,000 square feet versus the 31,000 square feet for restaurants and shops that the task force had recommended. The red that you see is the a kind of a gross outline of the old pier. This came out of the architect's basis of design book that they presented to City Council. Here is the overwater drive. Now this, because of cost cutting, it doesn't sweep out here. It doglegs back onto Second Avenue, cuts through the spa beach, and comes out here, as I've described before, with a turnaround. And this is all the vehicular traffic will be contained in this. Here is the above water bridge flying over. And now, instead of coming off a gently sloping ramp down to here, if you're on a bicycle, you're going to make about a 100 degree sharp turn here, start down a ramp that is an 8.3% ramp. That's 8 feet for every foot, for every 100 feet you're going down. Do a 180 degree turn right here and come down. Now, if you're pushing someone in a wheelchair, you're going to be doing the same thing. If you chose to push that person up a ramp where you had to climb 17 feet from here up to here to have the pleasure of using that upper bridge as opposed to simply coming back the way you came.
Excuse me, Bill.
Yeah.
You're not talking about the general public vehicular traffic going back and forth, are you?
No.
They don't, it's only the trolley or something?
Well, we have elevators out here. We have the trolley. They're talking about trying to put a small grill or restaurant out here. I don't know how the beer, you know, how's the beer going to get out there? How's the food? How is any repair truck? The emergency vehicle, someone is choking on a chicken bone, here come, you've seen the parade. Let me just jump you ahead to show you what this is the a paper by, again, this came out of the city's own documents. Here, their consulting engineers, this was in August of 2012, were working with a 24-foot wide bridge now. And here is their representation of an emergency vehicle with a pedestrian on a 24-foot wide bridge. Now, the problem that they were dealing with is what happens if you have some kind of public, any kind of emergency you could have out here, from a public disruption to an electrical fire in the elevator to a some kind of commotion happening out here, and you had a crowd of people trying to get off this bridge, off the pier, at the same time the emergency vehicles were trying to come out. Remember, this engineer was working with 24 feet. I'm not kidding you. This is not a joke. This is came out of the city's book. What they're saying, the green lines represent a flow of people trying to get off the pierhead, encountering a fire truck trying to get out to the pierhead. And the solution is a golf cart with a flashing light is going to go ahead and park the crowd.
Yvonne Edmonds.
I didn't make this up. I just downloaded it. This is the Basis of Design Book 2 that is available for download. Anyone? The canopy. First, let me show you this. This is awful to look at, but right here is a dotted line. That rectangle is 900 square feet. This room is at least 900 square feet. Is to be some kind of open grill. Now, if you have attended any presentations on this or looked at the artist's rendering, you will see tablecloths, white linens, chandeliers hanging. It has been, you know, portrayed as fine dining. But all that is going for the environmental permitting is a drawing like this that has a dotted line that says open grill. Elsewhere you will read that they will have electrical outlets for food trucks. You ask me what other kind of vehicles, they may have food trucks out there.
Bill, I want to make sure we leave them not time for questions.
Okay.
But you don't, and they don't envision having people driving back and forth out there like they do
now.
Huh?
No. So if you have a wedding party, say you wanted to have a wedding out here, you have to figure out how you're going to move 200 or 300 people, 1,500 feet, and just, you know, imagine the weather. This is a cross-section of the canopy. This is a canopy that is meant to be a crown on the eastern horizon. It really doesn't work well as a canopy. I sat down with my friend who's an MIT aeronautical engineer, and we played with this drawing. We added the arrows. This is a gust front from the typical thunderstorm that we get out over Tampa Bay in the spring, summer, and fall. Now there is a wall of air that very quickly is going to move from here to here. Only it's going to be channeled by this. So that air is going to be accelerated, and it is going to carry the rain right with it. There is no shelter out here. Zilch. I'm sorry. There's restrooms about 500 or 800 square feet, and they enlarged the gelato stand in this latest rendition from 250 square feet to 450 square feet. Let me take questions. I do want to talk to you about how this, where this process should go, and I'll make it short.
I have a question.
Yes.
You said to begin with that this proposal had been submitted to quite a few citizens, all of whom disapproved of it. Could you give us more details, please?
This
and
numbers? Not this proposal, but our telephone survey simply asked is, and this was in June of 2012, after all of these pictures of the lens and there had been some public debate, we simply asked, do you approve or disapprove of the lens, and do you want to have the city borrow money to build it? And we had, I can't quote the numbers, but they were way stronger than 50%. They were up in the 60s. Disapproval ratio was about 3-1 when you didn't mention financing, and about 5-1 when you did. That caused us to, we didn't want to go on a fool's errand, but that's all that did. But
okay, and one additional question, who is we?
A group of us, our board of directors, a gentleman named Bud Risser, Bill Bozeman, Fred Whaley, Dan Sullivan. Straining my mind now, and I'm meeting with all of them tomorrow morning. We are just all local St. Petersburg people who believe that we can do better.
Isn't there a name to the group?
Oh yeah, we are incorporated as Concerned Citizens of St. Petersburg, okay. Inc. We are registered as a political activity committee with the city. We publish, we file reports on the contributions that we receive. Yes?
You're against this proposal. Is there a proposal you're for, or you think they should go back and look for something else?
There is no specific proposal that we are for. The city has a waterfront master plan that is required under the city charter to be a complete review and update of it is due in July of 2015. Our position is that the entire waterfront that is under review from Bayboro Harbor to Coffee Pot should be looked at as a whole, this time with the input from our marine science community and the other communities, and to do this job right, getting a great deal of guidance from the work of the Peer Advisory Task Force. Now, the Peer Advisory Task Force probably was, because they had an impossible number on saving the pier, was not going to save the inverted pyramid. I think that that decision should be revisited, even if a new approach has to be built.
How did we get to this position? If you tried to come up with a bad idea, you couldn't come up with one as bad as this. Is there some conspiracy there? Somebody with a lead day fix that he pushed through? Is there incompetence or irresponsibility? Or is there just fuzziness about due process? How could we have gotten to this point as quickly, reasonably as we did? Conspiracy, irresponsibility, or lack of due process?
I made a vow I'm going to try stay away from that. Our system of governance does not let these council people talk to each other and have real conversations. That is a whole other subject. It is a dysfunctional decision-making process, and it has resulted in what we feel is a very flawed project, and that the time should be taken to get it right. Yes.
Where are they right now? Is there a possibility that they will go ahead with it? Is it a standstill? Or what's the status right now?
The status is that there are 5 phases to the architectural services agreement. They are in the second of those 5 phases now. That second phase is to be completed in April. If it receives further funding and continues, the final design is to be completed in November, with then bids being received. Our petition is a petition for city council to adopt an ordinance directing the mayor to terminate the architectural services agreement now. Under the charter, if the city council does not adopt that ordinance, then the question of whether that ordinance is adopted must be put to the voters of St. Petersburg in a referendum. That is how we get the vote on whether this is to be stopped. Yes?
I recently actually have a comment from the mayor. I didn't think he read his emails, but several weeks ago there was an article in the perspective section of the Tampa Bay Times on transportation, and there was an interest group here, Current Events, that had a large discussion on transportation. And I have to give credit to my brother-in-law, not myself, but over coffee when he was visiting us, we were discussing the amount of water we have here and why not look at potential ferry services between Tampa and here and utilize the water here. It's been done well in Seattle and New York City, Staten Island, and Bermuda and other countries. So I said, I think that's a great idea. I'll send an email to the mayor. So I did, and he called. And he said that we've been playing telephone tag, but he said he was interested to hear more about other options for the city of St. Petersburg. And that's all I know right now. So I don't know if anybody's ever proposed that.
The waterfront master plan would be a wonderful way to get out of that a minute and go back to right where we started. What you're talking about could be based in this protected basin that is totally underutilized. Now, Maltzahn wanted to put a bridge here and a road along some of the most valuable waterfront real estate you can imagine. This basin has never been utilized well because there's no breakwater here and there's a horrible surge that builds up. A breakwater would not be a really big deal, and that should be part of the waterfront master plan and a landing for a vessel or service like you're talking about coming off somehow off Second Avenue would make be easy to incorporate. But you don't do that out here on the open water. Yes, sir.
All of the other all ideas that you've heard, Bill, other than the lens, what would you if you were to pick an alternative today to say here's something better than the lens, what is it?
I would like to see an alternative that retains the inverted pyramid. But that is a personal wish, and I'm not speaking for the organization, because I want people a lot smarter than me and more of them providing ideas of how we can get more jobs. See, we're losing 400 people lose their jobs on May 31st. City Council is, and they're proud of the fact that they think that this new pier is going to operate with a tiny fraction of the number of people that the old pier. I think this waterfront should provide us more recreation, more education, and more entertainment. Look at that. There's nothing happening there. Not that green space is bad, but unlike North Shore Park, where you can find soccer games and all kinds of spontaneous activity, this is a wasteland. Yes, sir.
In a talk here fairly recently, the mayor of St. Petersburg said that in any event, the pier has to go because he claimed that the piling structure was about ready to be collapsed and needed to be condemned, and they've already condemned a part of it. Now, it sounds like what you say, there's a central core that evidently is viable.
Only right under here. I tend to agree that one way or another, at least $10 or $15 million are going to have to be spent to replace this causeway and the perimeter of the pierhead.
He's talking about the pilings.
Yeah.
Yes.
Pilings, but you didn't mention.
Well, I'm talking, that's the pilings that support this. There are pilings and all the cross beams and all that. Now, the caissons that support the inverted pyramid, they're good for who knows. I mean, people are very confident another 50 years.
A recommendation then that you're thinking of proposing, or maybe not, would be to redo the planning process.
Yes, sir. Absolutely. It's a failed process. And this, look at Tampa. They hired for the Tampa Museum, world class, Gary or somebody. They were going to, you know, do something. They fell back, regrouped. They have a wonderful museum over there. We failed. It took 6 years to come up with this. 67 to 73, the pier was closed. The world did not come to an end. Yes, sir.
Based on your scientific and economic projections, would there be any way to get a temporary injunction to stop the proceedings in place?
Kathleen Ford has a lawsuit. I practiced law here for 38 years. I intentionally did not get into that. I have not analyzed it. And you can get an opinion out of me on about anything, whether you want it or not, but
Kathleen,
you're not going to get one on that.
What is Kathleen Ford's petition? The nature she, of what she's going to ask.
She has one based on the concept that the demolition of the pier violates the charter. And I cannot explain that coherently for you, so I won't try. I believe another element of the lawsuit relates to a change in the in-town redevelopment plan. It's very technical, relates to inadequate notice that they were changing the project from renovation of the old pier into whatever the hell we want to build there. Yes.
Yes. I'm looking at pictures of the pier from this iPad. It seems like with any storm that comes along here, the reformulation of this creation is going to cost more, probably, than the building, or at least half of the building of the pier, just the canopy alone.
You mean it? You think it's vulnerable?
Yes.
Oh, they're building a wing. This is an engineering experiment. It was originally designed, and they bragged that they had the finest structural engineer in the world. And that finest structural engineer in the world had designed a precast concrete structure. Well, when budget time came in September, they shrunk the size of the tiara, which was the only good thing they did. But it went to being a galvanized steel frame with aluminum cladding. Now that spells corrosion problems. You're building what is essentially a tank that warm, moist salt air will be in during the day, and when that tank cools at night, it turns to salty water. No matter what you do to insulate the dissimilar metals, salty water will find a way to defeat you and get corrosion. So we, the taxpayers, are engaged in an experiment. On one of the slides, I had the statement about the